It's time now for Morning Rounds, our look at the top medical news of the week. Joining us are CBS News chief medical correspondent Dr. John Lapook and CBS News contributor Dr. Holly Phillips. There were lots of headlines this week from the annual meeting of the American Heart Association in San Diego. First up, a major new study reveals that people who have what seem like sudden heart attacks usually have warning signs. Researchers in Oregon followed more than a million people for 11 years. They found that more than half of all men who suffered sudden cardiac arrest had symptoms in the weeks before their attack. John, tell us about this study and how many people are involved.
Anthony, we're talking about 350,000 Americans who suffer sudden cardiac death each year, and it's devastating. Of course, it's devastating for the family and for the patient, but even more so when you think that it just came out of the blue and there were no warning signs. And now we're finding out, surprisingly, that in the month before, 53% of these people had symptoms. Now, typical ones, chest pain was the most, then shortness of breath, but even less frequently, like 4%, palpitation, dizziness, and even fainting.
So what should you do if you have these symptoms?
Well, certainly do not diagnose yourself. Now, the very first time that you have any new symptom, you should talk to your doctor, especially if it's something like chest pain and shortness of breath. We don't want a lot of people out there who have a little bit of dizziness panicking, but I think it really makes sense when you see what the consequences can be. Talk to your doctor, make sure you understand exactly what's going on.
All right. Also this week, some news for the millions of Americans who take aspirin to prevent heart disease. A new study suggests the pills might be most effective if you take them right before you go to bed. Holly, I think most people actually take them in the morning, don't they? So why is this better?
That's right, Anthony. It really all has to do with how aspirin prevents heart attacks, which is essentially by thinning the blood. It prevents the blood from clotting. So in this study, they looked at 290 patients. They had them take 100 milligrams of aspirin. At one point, they took the aspirin in the morning, and later in the study, they took the aspirin in the evening. It turns out if you take it at night, it has its greatest effect in the morning. The blood is essentially most thin in the morning and less likely to clot. That's important because heart attacks happen 3 times as often in the morning as opposed to the evening. So by taking your aspirin at night, you're getting the biggest benefit when you need it the most, which is in the morning.
That's interesting. Now, what if you're taking other medication as well? Does that change this?
You know, it's interesting, Anthony. Many people who take aspirin to prevent heart attacks are also taking statins, which are given in the evening. They also work in the evening best. So it might be easiest just to take your aspirin and statin at the same time.
Okay. And now here's another reason to quit smoking. A new study shows that people over 65 who kick the habit can reduce their risk of heart disease faster than previously thought. John, tell us about this study and what's new here.
Well, I love this study because, you know, we always want to say, is there ever a time when it's not a good thing to stop smoking? And there never is a time. They look at people at 65 and older, and they smoke the equivalent of one pack a day for, say, up to 32 years. And it turns out that if you stop smoking, your risk of either having heart failure or dying of heart disease goes down to baseline. In other words, as if you had never smoked, at a median, an average of about 8 years.
Yeah, so it's never too late to stop.
Never too late. It's really a good study.
Yeah.
Stop.
Okay. Princeton University announced this week that it will use a vaccine not yet approved in the U.S. to fight a meningitis outbreak on campus. 7 students have been infected with a less common form of the brain infection. As Elaine Quijano reports, the university got an emergency waiver from the FDA for a vaccine already being used in Europe.
Princeton officials announced they will make the vaccine available starting in early December to undergraduates and graduates living in dormitories and to people at the university with conditions that may make them vulnerable to the disease. Dr. William Schaffner studies infectious diseases at Vanderbilt University.
The Food and Drug Administration, in that kind of an emergency, has developed a process where unlicensed drugs, and in this case, a vaccine, can be introduced to be used just in that specific patient or in this public health circumstance.
Princeton students like Emma Kurz have been following news of the outbreak closely.
Everyone's sort of on their toes, as they should be, about the spread of this disease.
Will you get the meningitis B vaccine?
I think I will. I think I'd rather take the chance to try to be safe than to take the chance of being at high exposure.
Meningitis spreads through close contact, including coughing, kissing, sneezing, and sharing food and drinks.
The person can become semi-comatose or even comatose, and this can happen within a matter of hours.
John, how many people who get meningitis actually die from it?
It's about 10%. This can be a really devastating illness, and even if you survive, about 1 in 5 have some kind of long-term side effects. So it's a really big deal.
All right, thanks. Finally this week, Thanksgiving, of course, is just around the corner. And if your holiday recipes call for nuts, here's good news. The New England Journal of Medicine reported this week that people who eat nuts every day are more likely to live longer. Holly, tell us about the benefit of nuts.
Oh, well, where to start, right? Nuts are actually full of unsaturated fat. That's the good kind. They've got fiber, vitamins, antioxidants, pretty much anything you need. But this study was particularly interesting because it's not a cause and effect study, but it did show a link between nut eaters and a decreased risk of death. In particular, people who ate nuts were less likely to die from the biggest killers: heart disease, diabetes, stroke, respiratory illness. So it seems to have an overall good effect on our health. So I have to say, when the study came out, I was in the grocery store. I actually saw it on my email, on my phone. I said, okay, let me go back to that aisle. All of a sudden, you know, I redirected.
Remember that these were much healthier people in the first place.
Right.
They tended to exercise more, smoke less. They ate their fruits and vegetables. So it's not on top of the junk food. It's instead of the junk food.
Right. And nuts are filling, though. They might actually, if you have nuts every day, you might be less likely to reach for the potato chips.
Right. And so it's good to have nuts at the holiday table, especially if they're not your relatives. Dr. John LaPook, Dr. Holly Phillips, thanks so much.